19-year-old Brandon Swanson had just completed his first year of college. The Marshall, Minnesota native planned to spend the evening of Tuesday, May 13th, 2008, celebrating with friends and having a good time. All seemed to be going according to plan until Brandon's parents received a call from him at 1 in the morning. Brandon had gotten his car stuck in a ditch along some back roads which ran to the north of Highway 68, the main stretch of road that he would normally have been driving on. Why the young man elected to exit this main road and instead take gravel back roads is yet but one mystery in a case filled with them. When Brian and Annette Swanson arrived at the location Brandon directed them to, neither he nor his car were anywhere to be found. Believing he was near the town of Lind, Brandon elected to walk from his car, initiating a 47-minute phone call with his father while he did so. Throughout the call, Brandon described seeing the lights of a city in the distance, walking down gravel roads, hopping fences, and hearing the rushing of water. All of a sudden, Brandon shouted out an expletive, and then the call went dead. This was the last contact anyone ever had with Brandon Swanson. More than 10 years later, the mystery of what happened to Brandon Swanson remains a haunting story without any answers. Despite exhaustive searches, extensive publicity, and cell phone pings narrowing down an area, not a single shred of evidence has ever been found to show where Brandon may have gone. What happened to Brandon Swanson? And why, a decade later, does this answer continue to evade authorities and devastate a family? This is Trace Evidence, Episode 65, The Disappearance of Brandon Swanson. Welcome to Trace Evidence. I'm your host, Stephen Pacheco. Today we examine one of the most highly requested cases since the inception of Trace Evidence, the disappearance of Brandon Swanson. Before getting into the case, just a few notes about the show. Trace Evidence is a weekly true crime podcast focusing on a different unsolved case each week. Subscribe and listen via Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, and all of your favorite podcatchers. If you have questions, comments, or case suggestions, email me at traceevidencepod@gmail.com. Follow me on Twitter at traceevpod, on Instagram at traceevidencepod, or join the Facebook discussion group simply by searching for Trace Evidence. You can visit the website at trace-evidence.com for full episodes, social media links, merchandise, and more. Trace Evidence is also on Patreon, so if you'd like to support the show, please visit patreon.com/traceevidence, where you can get rewards such as stickers, pins, and commercial-free episodes. There's also a PayPal donation link on the website for those of you who don't wish to go through Patreon. This show is a complete one-man operation, and your support is greatly appreciated. This week we examine the disappearance of Brandon Swanson, a mysterious case filled with confusion, misinformation, and lacking almost any evidence whatsoever. This is Episode 65, The Disappearance of Brandon Swanson. Brandon Victor Swanson was born on January 30, 1989, to parents Brian and Annette. Brandon was raised alongside his sister in Marshall, Minnesota. Located in Lyon County in the southwest of the state, Marshall is the county seat and holds a population of just over 13,000 residents in 10 square miles. The town itself is located in a predominantly rural area known for agriculture, located approximately 148 miles southwest of Minneapolis, and the four main routes into Marshall are U.S. Highway 59 and State Highways 19, 23, and 68. Marshall was home to several schools, including Marshall High School, where Brandon would eventually attend. All in all, Marshall was an optimal choice for raising a family, with a tight-knit community and a violent crime rate less than half the average for the state of Minnesota. Brandon was the Swansons' only son, and was raised in a loving and caring environment by Brian and Annette. Showing signs of intelligence at a young age, Brandon was quick to develop skills when it came to reading comprehension, and he would be labeled as an avid reader throughout the rest of his life. Brandon was known to consume books at a rapid pace and could frequently be found with his nose pressed between the pages. Beyond reading, Brandon was what you might expect of a young man growing up in the 1990s. He was coming of age at a time where computers and the internet were exploding in popularity, and by the time he was 10 years old, the 1990s were coming to an end, and he would be entering his teen years in a world marked by advancements in computer technology and the ever-expanding landscape of video games. According to friends and family, even from a young age, Brandon had a passion for and an interest in science. He was captivated by the world around him, and yet more so, by finding the answers to the questions about how it all came together. Brandon's interest in science would remain with him throughout his life, and it was through the field of science that he would eventually make decisions regarding his future and college education. As a youngster, Brandon performed well in school and showed an aptitude for learning. He had the type of mind where he just soaked up knowledge, and he took pleasure in doing so. While he could easily allow himself to sink into the distractions of television or video games, he was also excited to learn new information. It was a zest and a hunger for knowledge which would stoke the fire inside of him for the rest of his life. The Swanson family was close, and Brandon is said to have been deeply devoted to his family. He took it upon himself to assist his parents whenever he had the ability and to look out for his sister. It was clear early on that Brandon possessed a dependability and a maturity which surpassed his age, and outside of a few minor issues that aren't all that uncommon in young men, Brandon was well behaved and his parents trusted him. At 15, he pursued and acquired a job at a local food store, known as Hy-Vee, and he would work there for the next 4 years. It was clear that when Brandon set his mind to something, he was going to achieve it. All in all, friends and family alike have described Brandon as being the kind of person who, when he said he was going to do something, he went through with it. If he offered to help out with a task, he'd be there, on time. This, along with his sharp mind and sense of humor, ingratiated him to those around him. Brandon was the type of guy who could get along with almost anyone, and when he made friends with someone, it was a lasting bond, built on mutual respect and loyalty. Brandon would graduate from Marshall High School in the summer of 2007. His chosen path would see him attending Minnesota West Community and Technical College in the town of Canby, approximately 30 miles to the northwest of Marshall. At Minnesota West, Brandon would enter a program which would see him studying in the science field, specifically wind turbines. It appeared that everything was going as Brandon had planned, and while he attended Minnesota West, he excelled in his program and was looking forward to carrying out a future for himself, doing something that he loved. As his first year of college progressed, Brandon began to examine other options, and made arrangements to transfer to Iowa Western Community College, located in Council Bluffs, Iowa. Council Bluffs was over 250 miles away from Marshall, and while Brandon lived at home with his parents while attending Minnesota West, his new plans would take him out on his own. Sadly, Brandon would never make it to his new school. As May of 2008 came around, 19-year-old Brandon was nearing completion of his first year at Minnesota West. Things had gone well, and Brandon was excited about future prospects and his transfer plans. Tuesday, May 13th would be the final day for classes at Minnesota West, and after completing the semester, Brandon had plans with some friends to celebrate the completion of the year. There was a small gathering being held at a house in Lind, Minnesota, approximately 8 miles to the southwest of Marshall. Brandon planned to attend, hang out with friends, and celebrate a successful year of school. According to attendees of the party, Brandon was one of five or six individuals who were present that night. Brandon was reported to have spent a period of time hanging out and having fun at the event itself, and it was described as a low-key event, not a raging party, but really a small gathering of good friends. There have been reports that, while present at this party, Brandon consumed at least one alcoholic drink, though his friends, when later questioned, reported that Brandon did not appear to be intoxicated or in any way impaired. How much Brandon drank, or what he was drinking at this particular get-together, has never been made clear. Sometime between 10:30 and 11 p.m., Brandon would exit the home in Lind with plans of driving to Canby, a 30-mile drive which would take him north past Marshall, and then a steady path to the northwest along Highway 68. It was a fairly straight shot utilizing a major roadway, and a trip which Brandon had made daily to attend school. The purpose of this trip was, apparently, to visit a friend from school who would be heading elsewhere, and Brandon wanted to have the opportunity to say goodbye. According to several reports, this home was having a party, though whether or not it was low-key as the previous event was, remains uncertain. It is known that alcohol was flowing at this get-together, and friends reported that Brandon had at least one shot of whiskey while present. Brandon, though, didn't stay long. The 30-mile drive would have him arriving sometime after 11 p.m. at approximately 11:15, and he was reported to have left prior to midnight. Once again, according to those who were present, Brandon appeared to be in good spirits, was happy and excited about completing the semester, and did not appear to be visibly intoxicated. Brandon left the party as the clock rolled past midnight, changing to Wednesday, May 14th. It's Brandon's exit from this second gathering which raises the first of many questions to come in this bizarre case. The drive from Canby to Marshall was, as previously stated, a fairly straight shot along Highway 68 in a southeastern direction. Brandon was very familiar with this roadway and drove it almost every day, but for an unknown reason, on this particular night, he made the choice not to take this road, instead opting for side streets and gravel back roads. There's been a great deal of speculation as to why Brandon made this choice, though the most common belief is that, having had at least two alcoholic drinks during the night, Brandon may have been concerned about the possibility of receiving a DUI. And so, rather than taking the more heavily traveled highway, which would have police along the way, he may have elected to take side roads in hopes of avoiding detection. It's important to note that this is purely speculation, and we have no way of knowing for certain what led Brandon to take these lesser traveled roads. There has been debate about how well Brandon would have known these roads. He wasn't exceedingly far from his hometown, and it's likely he may have been on one or many of these roads in the past, but if indeed alcohol was playing a role in his decision-making, this could have had an effect on his sense of direction. It should also be noted that Brandon was legally blind in his left eye, and so his driving abilities faced a slight challenge due to impaired depth perception. Regardless of how familiar Brandon may have been with these roads, having left the final party around midnight would have him traveling down winding gravel roads with little to no lighting through vast areas of vacant farmland. There wasn't much surrounding these roads, and their path wouldn't lead him in a straight shot. The gravel roads themselves do follow Highway 68, but not directly. The gravel roads are interconnected in a grid fashion, with some running north to south and others east to west. Imagine Highway 68 running from the northwest to the southeast, and then picture the gravel roads to the northeast of Highway 68 arranged like a side view of a staircase, with the east to west roads being the step and the north to south leading down to the next step. Essentially, Brandon would have to have made multiple turns to work his way down towards Marshall. Each of the east to west roads would lead to a new turn, which would take Brandon south. Then he'd have to make a turn to the east and then another to the south. For someone familiar with these roads, it likely wouldn't have been exceedingly difficult. But again, we're unaware of Brandon's familiarity with the gravel roads. Factor that in with poor lighting, already impaired vision, and the possibility of intoxication, and it isn't difficult to imagine how Brandon may have become disoriented along this path. At some point during the night, Brandon turned onto a maintenance road. The road is actually referred to as a field road and runs between two large crop fields and is predominantly made of dirt and grass. It's May at this time, and these crop fields were actually used for growing corn. Corn crop planting usually begins in these areas as early as April and continues through June, meaning that while Brandon was driving through this area of fields, they would have appeared mostly vacant, with the planting likely still occurring, though no crops to show for the time being. Brandon would have been in a dark, rural area, surrounded by a lot of flat, empty land, with few people around, especially at this time of night in the middle of the week. If you've lived in or visited rural areas such as these, the roads can be exceedingly dark, and headlights often don't illuminate a great deal of the path forward. Whether it was due to his disorientation, the likelihood of fatigue, as Brandon had attended final classes that morning, possible intoxication, or merely the darkness of that particular night, Brandon will eventually find himself stuck. While executing a turn, which would have brought Brandon back onto a gravel road, taking him further south, he misjudged the turn and found his vehicle caught in a ditch. The ditch has been described as mostly shallow, though this particular section of it had a steep decline, and Brandon's car, a green Chevy Lumina sedan, got its frame caught up on the ditch. Brandon attempted to free the car from its position by switching between both drive and reverse, but he quickly realized that he wasn't going to be able to get out of the ditch on his own. Brandon's collision into the ditch occurred at approximately 1:15 a.m., and while the vehicle had been disabled, the accident appeared to have happened at a low speed, while turning, and there was no outward damage to the vehicle. As such, Brandon himself would later report that he hadn't been injured in any way and that the accident wasn't severe and he was merely stuck. According to cell phone records later released by police, Brandon attempted to call a few friends to come and help him. It appears that Brandon was unable to get anyone to answer at this time, and at approximately 1:54 a.m., some 35 minutes after the accident, Brandon finally decided to call home and ask his parents for assistance. When Brandon spoke to his parents, he was able to describe to them where he believed he was. This is yet another incident in this case which will become the subject of speculation and a source for tremendous confusion. For whatever reason, Brandon believed that he was near the town of Lind. Specifically, he describes the location to his father as a gravel road which runs along a golf course between Lind and his hometown of Marshall. Marshall is only 8 miles from Lind, and upon being given this area to drive towards, both Brian and Danette Swanson hop into their pickup truck and begin heading towards this location. Unfortunately, when they arrive, neither Brandon nor his car is anywhere to be found. They were still on the phone with Brandon at this time, and frustration began to mount as Brandon felt he had given them the right location, but they simply couldn't locate him. When asked about this later, Brian stated, quote, "He was absolutely positive he knew where he was," end quote. Believing that perhaps they were in the right area, but that either they had driven too far or perhaps not far enough, Brandon's parents began flashing the lights on and off on their truck in hopes of getting his attention. At that time of night, in the pitch darkness, the lights could be seen for a great distance. Brandon got back into his car and began doing the same thing, but neither Brandon nor his parents saw the flashing lights from each other's vehicles. According to Annette, she told Brandon to look for their lights, and she could hear him clicking his lights on and off. But again, there was nothing but darkness around them. As frustration continued to grow between all three, Brandon and his mother had a spat, and he hung up. Annette later explained, quote, "At one point, he hung up on me, so I called him back and apologized," end quote. It was late at night now, and it was obvious that everyone was feeling the frustration. Annette's phone call to Brandon took place at 2:17 a.m., meaning that only 23 minutes have passed since the time Brandon originally called his parents about needing their help. Still believing that he was near Lind, Brandon explained that he was going to walk towards a friend's house in town. At this time, Brian decided he was going to drop Annette back off at home so that he could come back out and pick up Brandon. They agreed to meet in Lind in the parking lot of the Lindwood Tavern, a popular night spot in the town. Assuming that Brandon is where he believed he was, Brian made the short trip home, dropped off Annette, and then begins heading towards Lind. At approximately 2:23 a.m., Brandon and Brian will start what will be the final phone call between them. The call will ultimately end with a disturbing and haunting exclamation, which to this day, the cause of which has never been discovered. According to Brian, Brandon said he could see lights in the distance, which he assumed was the town of Lind, and so that was the direction he began walking. While walking, Brandon was describing his surroundings to Brian and explaining the terrain over which he was moving. This has become an area of confusion and speculation for many, as Brandon had assumed he was on gravel roads which ran alongside a golf course. However, as soon as he began walking, he should have known rather quickly that he wasn't near any golf course. While it was dark and the land was flat, many who have examined this case have been confused about how he still would have thought he was in the area where he'd originally told his parents. There isn't a great deal that tilled farmland has in common with the sprawling greenery of a golf course. At some point during the call, Brandon explained that the road was going to lead him to Lind, but it's going to take him longer. So instead, he plans to cut across fields near him and to just keep the lights of the town in front of him. Throughout the call, Brandon explains as he is crossing through fields and at one point mentions that he can hear water running nearby. Apparently, Brandon also makes mention of fences. As he crosses through the empty fields, he keeps running into various fences, and it's reported that he's growing frustrated and at some point makes a comment about running into yet another fence. During the time that Brandon is walking, Brian is still looking for his son. While he's concerned about him, he also feels somewhat secure in that Brandon isn't injured, is walking towards town, and appears to be doing fine. The weather that night was clear. There was a full moon, and the wind was blowing 6 to 9 miles per hour. The temperature was 46 degrees, though it would drop to a low of 39. This lent some concern, as there was uncertainty whether or not Brandon was dressed for the cold temperature. At approximately 3:10 a.m., in the midst of their call, Brandon suddenly shouts, "Oh shit," and the call goes dead. They had been on the phone for 47 straight minutes at this point. This will be the last time Brandon's parents ever hear from him. Not knowing what happened, Brian called out Brandon's name into the empty phone line multiple times. Brian later explained he thought he heard the sound of Brandon's foot slipping, though what this sounded like or how he could have been able to ascertain this detail is uncertain. After this, he begins calling his son back, but the phone simply rings and rings before depositing him to voicemail. Annette later explained, quote, "We called him back several times thinking, you know, he'll see the phone light up. Even if he didn't have it on ring, he would see his phone light up, and when the call came in, he'd find it. You know, he'd answer the call. And it just didn't happen time and again. It just went unanswered." End quote. The status of Brandon's phone is another area of this case that has been hotly debated as, for many, it's believed that because the phone rang before going to voicemail, it was likely not destroyed or turned off. However, research into this area suggests other possibilities. What a phone does when it's powered off or destroyed varies greatly based upon the carrier to whom the phone is assigned and what their particular setup is. In some instances, a phone won't ring when it's off or disabled, but in other situations, the ringing will continue to occur. But in reality, this is a signal from a network switch, and not actually the result of the phone ringing or being operational on the other end. Following the ending of the phone call, Brian didn't know what to do. At this time, he spoke with Annette and they began calling friends of Brandon's in hopes that they might know where he could have been located. They were also hoping to get volunteers to come out into the late night, early morning hours in an attempt to try and locate Brandon. Searching for Brandon will last throughout the night, with Brian as well as some of Brandon's friends searching extensively along Highway 68 and many of the side roads and gravel roads which run near it. Despite driving around, calling out Brandon's name and countless calls to his cell phone, no one is able to locate any sign of Brandon or his car. This is partly due to the fact that while Brandon had been certain of his location, he had been far off in his assumptions and was actually nowhere near where he believed he was. This will become a hindrance to search efforts for Brandon early on. As the moon slowly sank beneath the horizon and the sun began to rise, Brian's parents decided that it was time to involve the authorities. At 6:30 a.m. on Wednesday, May 14th, the Swansons contacted the Lind Police Department to file a missing persons report. Almost immediately, the Swansons were upset by the approach of the police department. The basic thought from investigators at the time was that it wasn't exactly unheard of for a college boy to have a few drinks and spend the night out, failing to come home when he was supposed to. This made little sense in this case because it wasn't a matter of Brandon simply failing to come home. He had specifically called his parents and was trying to guide them towards him to pick him up. Why law enforcement had this reaction has been a great source of frustration for the Swanson family, and it's been argued that, had they reacted faster and launched a search sooner, perhaps the answers in this haunting mystery would have been discovered. In a statement that can only be described as callous and cold, Annette Swanson reported that one particular officer told her that, as an adult, Brandon had a right to be missing if he wanted to be. The Swanson family were extremely discouraged by the response from law enforcement, and while they certainly didn't rush into action, the Lind Police Department did alert officers about Brandon's disappearance, and their first step into the investigation was to obtain copies of Brandon's cell phone records in hopes of narrowing down his last known location. Much to the surprise of both law enforcement and the Swansons, it was through these cell phone records that the truth was finally revealed. While Brandon had assured his parents of his location, he'd been way off. He believed he was just off Highway 23 near Lind, but his cell phone pinged off a tower in Mineata, and subsequent pings showed that he had actually been near the cities of Taunton and Porter, approximately 25 miles from Lind. While this aroused confusion, it did finally explain why his parents had been unable to locate him despite his directions. At this point, the Lind Police Department reached out to the Lyon County Sheriff's Department for assistance in their search. Utilizing the location set by the cell phone pings, search efforts were moved north of Lind into the area between Taunton and Porter. Sheriff Joe Dahl agreed to assist, and now two departments were involved in the investigation. Though by the time further searches were conducted, it will become a confusion of multiple jurisdictions. While searching back roads in this newly defined area, Brandon's vehicle was finally discovered. The green Chevy Lumina was found on a gravel road 1 mile north of Highway 68 along the Lincoln County line. As was protocol, Lincoln County Sheriff Jack Vizecki was notified and brought into the investigation at this time. According to investigators at the scene, the car had gotten hung up on an incline at the edge of the road. There was no damage to the vehicle, but the incline had been extreme enough that the wheels on that particular side of the car weren't touching the ground, which had ultimately made it impossible for Brandon to correct the issue by trying to reverse out of it. While the discovery of Brandon's car was a major leap forward in the search for him, it provided authorities with more questions than answers. They now knew for certain that Brandon had no idea where he was, had obviously been disoriented believing he was elsewhere, and they had no way of determining which direction he may have walked off in. Being that the road was gravel, and the surrounding areas were farmland and grass, they weren't able to locate any tracks which might suggest to them where Brandon went. Exploration of this particular area showed that, while Brandon believed he had been walking towards the lights of Lind, he may have actually been walking towards the lights of Porter, though this detail cannot be confirmed. Sheriff Dahl, while at the scene of the car, noticed a red light atop a grain elevator in the distance. It was believed to have been possible that Brandon may have seen this light and thought that it was connected to the city of Porter, which at the time he thought was Lind. However, with no certainty about direction or what area to search, and with daylight quickly fading, the decision was made that Sheriff Dahl would reach out to the Cottington County Search, Dive, and Rescue Team for assistance, primarily with the use of tracking dogs. The search would be conducted the following morning, Thursday, May 15th, at 11 a.m. On Thursday morning, multiple attempts were made for tracking dogs to pick up on Brandon's scent from the vehicle itself. However, despite this attempt, tracking dogs were not able to get Brandon's scent and did not lead investigators anywhere. At that time, it was decided to use an article of Brandon's clothing to give the dogs a scent to try and follow. This worked, at least for one particular dog, and it began leading police away from the vehicle. The dog led officers south for half a mile before turning west onto 390th Street. The dog continued down 390th Street for a mile before turning north onto County Road 16. The trail continued for another half a mile before turning west into the driveway of an abandoned farm. The trail was followed for approximately a quarter of a mile before turning northwest, following the general direction of the Yellow Medicine River. At one point, the tracking dog actually jumped into the Yellow Medicine River, leading many to believe that Brandon may have fallen in. However, the dog did not remain in the water. It exited and continued to track the scent. The scent was followed to a drainage point for the river, and then turned north towards a gravel road, which functioned as a boundary line between Lincoln and Yellow Medicine counties. Once up on the gravel road, however, the dog lost the scent and could track it no further. It should be noted that this particular stretch of road had been regraded that morning, and while it can't be known for certain, there are many who believe that this is the reason the dog could no longer detect Brandon's scent. When it comes to tracking dogs, every factor must be considered, and something as small as the wind shifting can dramatically affect the dog's ability, so the disruption of the gravel and turning over of the earth in that area could certainly have been enough to cut the trail short. The path that the dog led investigators on did make sense, though. During his call with his father, Brandon mentioned walking on gravel roads and then turning off the road to take a shortcut towards the light in the distance. He made mention of two particular fences that he came into contact with, and there were two fences along the way that the dog had led. Brandon reported hearing rushing water, and the Yellow Medicine River was nearby. It has been determined that, on average, a human being will walk between 1 and 3 miles per hour. Knowing that Brandon began walking while on the phone with his father, and that the call lasted for 47 minutes, this places Brandon anywhere between 3/4 of a mile and 2.5 miles away from his car. The tracking dog, while leading investigators, never ventured further than the 2.5 miles, meaning that the path the dog had led them through was within the possible search radius. While the search dog was leading investigators, the area itself was being searched by multiple groups. There was aerial support as a search team conducted flyovers. Search dogs were being utilized to try and pick up anything that might lead them to Brandon. Volunteers were searching the area around Brandon's vehicle, spinning out wider and wider radiuses, while a team from the Department of Natural Resources took to the Yellow Medicine River by boat. Considering the path that the dog had led them at this time, the Yellow Medicine River became a major focus point for investigators. With the assistance of the Department of Natural Resources, gates were placed in the river. These gates are used to catch anything which may be floating through, including a body. Sheriff's Department investigators searched along the banks of the river, utilizing foot searches, horseback, and all-terrain vehicles. The Yellow Medicine River itself has been a point of some confusion for those who have examined this case. The river runs a total of 107 miles through southwestern Minnesota. For the most part, the river isn't much of a river. Locals in the area where Brandon vanished from have described it as a creek, and for the most part, this is true. The river typically doesn't run very deep. However, during the arrival of spring, as the snowfall melts in the area, this builds up and washes down into the Yellow River, causing it to increase the speed of its flow while also rising in depth. Sheriff John Vizecki described it, stating, quote, "After the snow melts, there's a huge amount of water that is channeled into the area where Brandon went missing. The river becomes a torrent of water that's anywhere from 7 to 8 feet deep. If you get on down the bottom of the river, there's areas where it could be as high as 15 feet deep." End quote. It should be noted that Sheriff Vizecki walked the banks of the Yellow Medicine River every day for 30 days after Brandon disappeared. The official searches themselves continued for the same 30 days, though each subsequent search saw less and less manpower assigned by law enforcement. The river itself has been the subject of multiple searches, drags, and dives. Despite exhaustive efforts from both law enforcement and volunteer search teams, not a single shred of evidence has ever been uncovered to suggest that Brandon did fall into the river. After all of this time, it's believed that had Brandon fallen into the river, something would have turned up by now. To this day, not even an article of Brandon's clothing has ever been recovered, and despite multiple land and air searches surveying the entire area from where Brandon disappeared, nothing has ever been discovered. His phone, a Motorola Silver, has never been found either. While it pinged in the area, and the Minneota cell tower showed that he had to have been within a 5-mile radius at the time he was on the phone with his father, investigators have never been able to pinpoint any particular location. Another area which drew the attention of tracking dogs, and thus investigators, was a watershed area approximately 6 miles from the location at which Brandon's car was discovered. The area is north of Porter. Jeff Haas, of Midwest Technical Rescue Training, has been involved in multiple searches for Brandon, and it's his belief that Brandon could likely be in the watershed area known to some as the Mud Creek, a tributary for the Yellow Medicine River. When discussing this particular location, Haas stated, quote, "We've got huge amounts of scents in here, more than I've ever seen in any other search. So we are really confident that he's somewhere in the watershed. We just can't get that final point." End quote. It is Haas's theory that Brandon likely, while walking in the darkness that night, have stumbled and dropped his phone, either breaking it, dropping it into the water, or perhaps even dropping it with enough force that the battery popped out and Brandon couldn't locate it. At this time, he described Brandon as being exhausted, damp, cold, and wandering further and further away from his car, exposing himself to more of the elements of the cold sweeping in that night. In total, searches for Brandon have covered more than 120 square miles, utilized over 45 highly trained dogs guided by 35 handlers from more than 9 different states. Over 1,900 canine searches have been conducted, and countless acreage of farmland, riverbanks, and fields have been exhaustively pored over by law enforcement and volunteers alike. The searches have been gridded, recorded and marked with GPS coordinates in order to keep meticulous track of every inch that has been searched in hopes of locating Brandon. For the Swanson family, it was utterly devastating. As the years began passing, it became clear that the answers were not going to be revealed anytime soon. Brandon's fate became a haunting mystery for them. The night Brandon vanished, they had turned their porch light on in hopes that he was wandering towards home and he'd find his way lit. In a solemn act of pain, that only a family can ever understand. That porch light remains turned on every night in the hope that Brandon might return someday. In an absolutely heartbreaking exchange, Annette Swanson described a conversation she had with her daughter, saying, quote, "I talked to my daughter about it this summer, and I said to her, you know, I'm not sure Brandon is going to be found in my lifetime. And she said, Mom, I don't think he's going to be found in my lifetime." End quote. While many families in similar circumstances might succumb to their grief and allow their lives to come to a screeching halt, the Swansons have been proactive in their pain. Still upset by the Lind Police Department's initial nonchalant attitude about Brandon's disappearance, Annette met with Marty Seifert, a member of the House of Representatives, and together they worked on new legislation. Seifert introduced a bill entitled Brandon's Law, which altered the Minnesota Missing Child Program, changing the word child to person. This law requires that when someone is reported missing, be the individual a child or an adult, law enforcement must immediately take the report and initiate an investigation. The law also states that when someone is reported missing, jurisdiction is given to the county or city from which the victim originates. This is designed to help clear up confusion and jurisdictional arguments, such as the confusion which came on early in Brandon's disappearance when multiple counties and cities were involved in the investigation. The bill officially became law in July of 2009, and in the years since, four other states have passed similar laws. While this bill was inspired by Brandon's case, it couldn't assist him at the time of his disappearance, but it is believed that the bill has resulted in saving lives since it became a law. In 2010, 2 years after Brandon vanished, the Minnesota Bureau of Criminal Apprehension took over as the lead agency on his case. A tip line was set up, and by 2015, only 90 tips had come in. In cases such as these, with the disappearance of a young man in the middle of nowhere, with as much publicity and attention as Brandon's case has gotten, this is an extremely low number of tips to receive in a 5-year span. The official area of interest in this case, and the target of subsequent searches, remains the Mud Creek watershed north of Porter, though to this day, not a single trace of Brandon Swanson has been found there. Multiple dogs have detected the scent of a body in this area, but searchers have failed to reveal where that body may be and whether or not it is in fact that of Brandon Swanson. Brandon's disappearance is a highly debated, controversial, and frustrating case which has been examined closely by law enforcement and civilian investigators alike. Considering the mysterious circumstances under which the 19-year-old seems to have inexplicably vanished, multiple theories have been suggested over the years in hopes of providing answers to this incredibly baffling disappearance. Most of the speculation on this case falls into one of three separate theories. The first theory suggests that Brandon, cold, possibly wet, and wandering around in the bitter cold of the night, may have found himself lost, injured, or suffering the effects of hypothermia. Proponents of this theory believe that Brandon is likely out there, somewhere, having died as a result of exposure to the elements. The second theory follows the thought process of an accident. Many believe that Brandon may indeed have stumbled and fallen into the Yellow Medicine River, while others have considered the possibility that Brandon may have fallen into an old well, hole, or cistern in the area, which has yet to be uncovered, and that vegetation in the area has grown over, concealing Brandon's whereabouts. The third and final theory suggests that Brandon may have been the victim of foul play. Supporters of this theory have a wide array of possibilities, including that Brandon may have been struck by a car, could have been accidentally shot and killed by a farmer in the middle of the night, or may have been picked up by someone offering him a ride who had malicious intentions and eventually drove him off somewhere to murder him and conceal his body. When last seen, Brandon Swanson was described as being a Caucasian male with brown hair and blue eyes, standing 5 feet 6 inches tall and weighing approximately 120 pounds. Brandon wore black wire-framed glasses, had pierced ears, and a small scar above his left eye. He is legally blind in his left eye. At the time of his disappearance, Brandon was wearing a white t-shirt under a blue striped polo sweatshirt, baggy blue jeans, a black hooded zip-up jacket with an emblem on the back, a white, flat-billed Minnesota Twins baseball cap turned to the side. He wore white sneakers, a heavy sterling silver necklace, and had one stud earring in each ear. At the time of his disappearance, Brandon would have had his black Motorola silver cell phone, wallet, and ID, as well as his keys on him. None of these items have ever been found. It's been over 10 years since Brandon Swanson vanished into the darkness of rural Minnesota. Then, 19 years old, with a promising future and a lot of dreams. If alive today, Brandon would be 29 years old. The possibilities of what he may have become are endless, and for his family, they look back upon their son and brother as a beautiful human being whom they miss endlessly. To this day, the porch light continues to burn through the darkness of the nights in hopes that someday Brandon will find his way home, though for the most part, his family have accepted the likelihood that if Brandon ever is found, it's unlikely that he's alive. The family has elected not to hold a memorial service for Brandon, believing that eventually the answers will be found, and only then will they officially be free to mourn. Until he is found, in their mind, he's out there somewhere, and they have to locate him. When asked about the searches for Brandon and their effect upon the family, Annette Swanson responded, quote, "When you have lost somebody, but you have no answers, there's no knowing where they are or even what happened to them. Your brain is in a constant state of trying to figure it out, but you don't have anything to go on. It's searching. It's searching for answers. It's searching for where, who, what, when, why, and you can't find it." The disappearance of Brandon Swanson is one of those cases that sticks with you once you learn about it. The further you dig into the case, the less it seems like you understand, and all of the circumstances that occurred that night in May of 2008 become more and more haunting. How many choices could have been made that evening that would have resulted in an absolutely normal and uneventful situation? Had Brandon stayed on Highway 68, would he have made it home? If he'd known his location, would his parents have gotten there before he chose to walk off towards the city? Was it even the city he saw in the distance, or merely the glow off a grain elevator light? These are all questions for which we have no answers, and questions that continue to disturb everyone who examines this most cryptic disappearance. There is something exceedingly troublesome about the phone call, the idea that Brandon was on the phone with his father, and then something, we still don't know for sure what, occurred, causing him to scream out, and the phone went silent. What was it that could have happened to Brandon? Did he come across something he shouldn't have? Did he fall? Again, these are questions which continue to be asked some 10 years later. In many ways, this case parallels another infamous disappearance, that of Brandon Lawson. Both men were on their phones, both men appeared to have experienced something which jarred them, both men had family members on their way to find them, both men walked away from their vehicles in rural areas, and both men have never been found. Both cases have very little evidence, very little information, and very few leads, if any. In the case of Brandon Swanson, investigators are torn on what may have occurred. While some believe Brandon fell into the river, others have argued that he could have come across foul play. Law enforcement has said, since early on in this case, that they've never found anything to suggest foul play occurred. But when you really examine the details, The truth of the matter is, they've never found anything to suggest anything that may have occurred. The only real leads in this case have been a radius based upon Brandon's cell phone pings and the hits that a tracking dog and cadaver dogs have made over the years. When you add it all up, there isn't much to go on, and when it comes down to what happened to Brandon, it's as mysterious today as it was a decade ago. In the absence of evidence, three prime theories have been purported over the years in an attempt to provide insight into what may have happened. The first of these theories suggests that Brandon, wandering further and further away from his car, may have eventually lost his life due to exposure to the elements. Minnesota is cold. Even in May of 2008, the temperature was 46 degrees with a low of 39. That's between 3 and 7 degrees Celsius. We know, based on Brandon's friends who saw him that night, that while he wasn't dressed for summer, he also wasn't dressed to be out in the bitter cold for more than a short period of time. A sweater over a t-shirt and a zip-up hoodie aren't exactly the warm kind of clothing one would want when wandering around in the cold darkness of rural Minnesota. Brandon was walking down uneven gravel roads, over farmland that was tilled, through empty wilderness besides a river. It isn't impossible to imagine he could have stepped into a puddle, soaking his feet and socks through his shoes. As the cold slowly built up around him, Brandon certainly could have begun to experience the onset of hypothermia, especially if, as some believe, he did in fact enter the river at some point in time. Hypothermia has a set of symptoms which occur as onset begins. These symptoms include shivering, slurred speech, slow breathing, weak pulse, clumsiness, drowsiness, confusion, and loss of consciousness. Were Brandon to have begun experiencing these symptoms in the middle of nowhere, it isn't hard to imagine he could have become even more disoriented than he already was. While he believed he was walking toward a town, we honestly have no idea of knowing if that's what was happening. Once Brandon left the road, the ability to track him became a lot more complicated. In most cases, when you're lost, you're advised to stay with or near your vehicle. It's simply far too easy to get lost out there, and the longer Brandon walked, the lower the moon sank and the darker the night became. By the time his phone cut off, the moon was nearly gone and he had no light source. Without his phone, he had nothing to guide him. Even were his phone operational at this time, it wasn't a smartphone. He didn't have the ability to access GPS or even a map app to help lead his way. We also have to consider the fact that Brandon had been drinking earlier. We don't know how much Brandon had, though many believe that the entire reason he avoided Highway 68 was because he might have been intoxicated. Initially, this would explain his confusion and being disoriented about his location. When you're driving down a main road like Highway 68, you know about how long it should take you to get home. Taking the side roads is going to be slower, and for Brandon, he may have assumed he was closer to home simply because of how long he'd been driving. Alcohol also plays a role in body temperature. While it's a common trope in films and books to take a shot of alcohol to fight off the cold, this actually isn't how it works. If you've ever been drinking and gotten that warm feeling in your face, it isn't because the alcohol is raising your body temperature. Alcohol actually causes the blood vessels in your skin to dilate, moving blood away from your core and vital organs into your extremities. Essentially, you're redistributing the heat in your body without actually altering the temperature. When you're cold, your body's natural inclination is to redirect blood from your extremities into your core to keep vital organs protected. So basically, consuming alcohol when it's cold outside actually accomplishes the opposite of what your body is trying to do to protect itself from something like hypothermia. Adding to the danger is because your blood being diverted to your extremities, your body may begin to believe it's actually hot, which will cause you to begin sweating. This, combined with the cold, will actually accelerate the process of hypothermia setting in. The fact of the matter is, it isn't impossible by any stretch of the imagination for Brandon to have become cold, slipped into hypothermia, gotten disoriented, began wandering off in a different direction, and either simply lost consciousness or found himself falling into the Yellow Medicine River. The river, in this case, seems like the more likely possibility, but we'll cover that more extensively in the second theory. When it comes to Brandon dying due to exposure, there are a few issues that have been brought up. Primarily, the area in which Brandon was known to have been has been searched extensively time and time again. It's unlikely that he wouldn't have been found by now, though this is a possibility which can't be entirely ruled out. If Brandon's thought process wasn't working properly at the time, he could have ended up in any number of areas and may have even gone somewhere dangerous in order to warm himself up or get protection from the elements. Imagine a hole in the earth, an abandoned building, or any number of other possibilities. Remember, tracking dogs did lead investigators across the land to an abandoned farm. The one detail of the case which in some ways contradicts the idea of hypothermia and exposure to the elements is the fact that Brandon shouted, "Oh shit." This isn't likely to have occurred because he was suddenly realizing how cold he was or that hypothermia was setting in, but the exclamation doesn't necessarily mean he didn't ultimately perish of exposure either. This scream has been a great source of speculation, but the fact of the matter is, we don't know enough to really weigh in on it. How he said it, the tone in his voice, any sounds accompanying it are uncertain. This could have been something Brandon said as he stumbled over a rock or a tree root, or as he fell into the Yellow Medicine River, or as he saw someone or something that scared him. There simply isn't enough information here. It does seem likely that whatever occurred at the time either resulted in Brandon losing his phone or it becoming disabled. Without his phone to reach out, without the ability to communicate with anyone, he'd have been on his own, wandering in the darkness from that point on, and frankly, he could have ended up nearly anywhere. The possibility that Brandon died as the result of exposure to the elements, the onset of hypothermia, or any number of factors related to the cold temperatures and his lack of winter clothing is one which cannot be outwardly ignored. Beyond the possibility of death due to exposure, many believe that Brandon may have experienced some kind of an accident, which ultimately led to his disappearance and likely his death. Firstly, much of law enforcement believes that Brandon likely fell into the Yellow Medicine River. At this time of year, it was surging from the spring runoff, and while it was normally a calm creek which could have been handled easily, at this time, Brandon would have found himself in rushing waters that were anywhere between 8 and 15 feet high. Being that it's a river that cuts through the landscape, it's certainly possible that Brandon could have fallen in and hit his head on a rock and become unconscious, or even gotten tangled up in roots and vines and pulled down beneath the rushing water. There's also the possibility that Brandon could have fallen into the river and gotten out of it, but now being soaked, this could have led him much quicker towards the possibility of hypothermia. If indeed Brandon's "oh shit" moment was him falling into the river, it isn't difficult to imagine all of the dangers that would go along with it. The riverbank itself was described as being dotted with trees, sunken in spaces, and quickly changing terrain. Brandon was blind in one eye and therefore had impaired depth perception. Had he been wandering in the dark for nearly an hour, and with very little light to go by, it isn't hard to imagine he could have stumbled. Sure, he could hear the river, but if he was simply trying to get near it to follow it, or if he was trying to cross over it, the possibilities of an accident are endless. The question then becomes, if Brandon did fall into the river and couldn't get out, where is he now? Search efforts have continually led searchers to the Mud Creek watershed area, where the Yellow Medicine River spits out much of its surplus. As the name describes, this can be a muddy and boggy area, and it isn't difficult to imagine that a body could easily have been washed down into this area and buried into the mud as the spring runoff continued. Bodies of water, such as rivers, have an immense ability to move earth and bury anything along the way. Multiple cadaver dogs have indicated the scent of human decomposition in this area, and for now, searchers have simply been unable to locate Brandon. The possibility that he fell into this river is certainly high up on the list and cannot be ruled out by any stretch of the imagination. Outside of the river itself, there have been other possibilities suggested. The area in which Brandon was wandering was mostly farmland, and much of it had been abandoned or in disuse. Many believe it's possible Brandon could have fallen into an exposed well or cistern, or perhaps one which had a weak and damaged board covering it. This again is a possibility which has to be taken seriously. Investigators believe they have looked into and examined all of the possible well and cistern locations in the area, but we have no way of knowing if that's accurate. There could be old abandoned wells or cisterns nearby that fell into disuse and new ones were created, thus ignoring and leaving behind the old one. Throughout all of this farmland, there could have been any number of holes or sunken in spots into which Brandon could have fallen and become injured or unconscious, which then would have increased the possibility of hypothermia and dying of exposure. If Brandon stepped onto unsure ground and fell into something, that might have resulted in him crying out the way that he did. His father believed he heard the sound of Brandon losing his footing. When it comes to the accident theory, it does seem a little more likely that Brandon would fall into the river, but the lack of his remains or any sign of him ever being found certainly leaves the door open for the possibility that he may be somewhere beneath the earth on one of those farms. The third and final theory in the disappearance of Brandon Swanson inserts the possibility of foul play. In terms of the foul play in this case, there's really two branches of it: accidental foul play and purposeful foul play. Starting with accidental first, one of the first thoughts I had about this case, and many others have as well, is that Brandon may have been struck by a car. It's hard to imagine a lot of people would have been driving around those back roads at this time, but if someone was, they likely weren't expecting to come upon a 19-year-old wandering around out there at 3 in the morning. Because we don't ultimately know where Brandon ended up, the possibility that he could have gotten back onto one of the gravel roads and then a car came whipping around the corner and struck him is a possibility which can't be dismissed. If indeed these side roads were utilized by people attempting to avoid police for one reason or another, it's certainly possible there was a drunk driver on the road that night who wouldn't have expected to run into a person way out there. If someone had struck Brandon, they'd have to make the choice as to whether or not to report it. Considering the status of this case, it seems apparent this person would have elected not to report it. At this time, the driver would have had to have taken Brandon, loaded him into their vehicle, and then taken him somewhere to dispose of him. That could have been any number of locations, and perhaps that's why tracking dogs got to the road and then the scent stopped. Had Brandon entered a vehicle, this is a scenario which could have led to those results. Of course, this person would have damaged their car, and there'd likely be signs that an accident had taken place. Skid marks, blood, pieces of the vehicle itself, none of that was ever located. But if it occurred on the road which had gotten regraded the next morning, all of that could have been swept beneath the dirt and gravel. We don't even know who regraded the road. It certainly wasn't local municipalities. In rural areas such as this, it isn't uncommon for a local to do it. That even opens the possibility that Brandon could have been there when this happened, and perhaps it was done purposefully to conceal his remains. Outside of a car accident, another theory that has been purported is that a farmer in the area may have heard someone on his property, and going out to find out what was happening could have brought a gun along with him. Seeing an individual wandering around your property in the middle of the night, some believe the farmer or property owner may have fired at Brandon to scare him and accidentally hit him, or purposefully targeted him, thinking it was someone planning to rob their property or home. This theory is somewhat of a stretch, and while it was addressed in the Brandon Lawson case, it doesn't seem to make as much sense in this case. As far as searches and investigations have gone, none of the property owners in that area have refused to allow law enforcement or search teams access to their property. It doesn't appear that anyone in that area has a deep desire to conceal anything, but again, we have no way of knowing. it's a possibility that Brandon could have been murdered by someone in this fashion, though it does seem like one of the lesser possibilities. The final section of this theory follows the thought process that Brandon may have come upon someone that night who, under the guise of helping him, may have had malicious motives behind their actions. If Brandon were walking through the dark and vacant area, the likelihood of another driver coming along isn't very high, but the possibility can't be ignored. We're talking between 3 and 4 a.m. for the most part, so someone could have been heading home from a club or a bar, and like Brandon, elected to take the back roads to do so. Along the way, this person may have seen Brandon, a fresh-faced 19-year-old boy who was clearly lost and cold. It isn't hard to imagine that if Brandon was indeed cold and tired, he'd have gratefully accepted a ride were someone to offer one. There's also the possibility that Brandon, in desperation, could have seen a passing motorist and flagged them down for assistance. Once Brandon entered this person's car, any number of things could have happened. The driver could have produced a weapon and used it to control Brandon. The driver could have told Brandon he was going to drive him back to his car or into town and simply took him somewhere else to murder him for whatever sick and sadistic reason someone would do that. Brandon's scent stopped on the road, and for some that implies that he may have entered a vehicle. If his phone was disabled, as it appears to have been, there's little Brandon could do, and if the driver had a weapon, it would be hard for him to escape. Those dark, vacant back roads likely lead to many locations where a person is unlikely to be found, if disposed of, and the person on that road could easily have been aware of abandoned farms or other locations that may have been a good place to conceal a crime such as this. The one area of this theory which makes it seem less likely is what are the chances that someone just happened to be driving those back roads at this time of night and came upon Brandon and was also the kind of person who would just randomly kill a young man for no apparent reason at all. There is, of course, another possibility. Brandon may in fact have been given a ride by someone and been dropped off in either Porter or Taunton, and at that point in time, any number of dangers could have come to fruition. Brandon could have run into any number of individuals wandering the streets at night looking for trouble. The problem with this aspect of the theory is, no one ever contacted authorities to state that they had given a young man a ride that night, and no one in either Taunton or Porter reported seeing anyone fitting Brandon's description. Also, one would have to assume that had Brandon made it to the city, he'd have tried to have called his parents from either a payphone or by asking the driver to take him to the police department. He even could have asked if he could have used the driver's cell phone. Some believe that Brandon made it into the city that night, but much like the rest of this case, there is simply no evidence to show it. Foul play is a possibility, and unfortunately in this case, almost everything is a possibility. Whether you believe that Brandon died of exposure, fell into the Yellow Medicine River, or met with someone who purposefully took his life, these are all theories which have their pros and cons, their supporters and their detractors, and none of them can be completely proven or disproven. As has been the case when it comes to the disappearance of Brandon Swanson, the answers to this mystery remain evasive and concealed somewhere in the rural landscape of southwestern Minnesota. We can only hope that someday, someone may come forward with answers, or Brandon himself will be located. 10 years have passed since his family last saw Brandon, and for them, each day is another reminder of the son and brother they loved and lost. For their sake, hopefully the answers will be found, but until then, the disappearance of Brandon Swanson remains open, unsolved, and very cold. If you're looking for more information about the disappearance of Brandon Swanson, there are many websites and news articles which discuss his case. The Trail Went Cold podcast did a mini episode on Brandon's story, and Thinking Sideways touched on the case a few years back. If you have any information about the disappearance of Brandon Swanson, please contact the Lind Police Department, Lyon County Sheriff's Department, your local police, or the FBI. What do you believe happened? Tweet me at TraceEvPod, message me on Instagram at TraceEvidencePod, email me at TraceEvidencePod@gmail.com, or comment in the Facebook group. I want to give a special shout out to Patreon producers Krista Colvin, Diane Dyson, Kate Alexander, Lucy LaRue, Lynn Merschel, and Sarah Burrow. Make sure you check your emails, as I'm awaiting responses from several of you regarding your trace evidence gear. Your support makes this show possible. If you're interested in supporting Trace Evidence, visit patreon.com/traceevidence. If you've enjoyed this episode, please rate and review the show on iTunes, Stitcher, or whatever podcast app you're using. The more ratings and reviews the show gets, the more people are able to hear these unsolved cases. For more information about other cases, transcripts, media, and more, please visit the website at trace-evidence.com. This completes this week's episode. I want to remind you that Trace Evidence is available on Spotify now, so make sure you go and check it out there. Also, please visit truecrimelist.com and give Trace Evidence a vote. It would certainly help grow the podcast, and I'd really appreciate it. Thank you for listening, and I hope you'll join me next week for another unsolved case on the next episode of Trace Evidence.